Good evening, Sawadee Krap. It is a joy tonight on behalf of Swanmok Bangkok BIA and the International Lay Sangha to welcome back to Thailand Ajahn Santikaro. Actually, for maybe some of you, Thailand is your land of birth, but for Santikaro, Thailand is the land of his Dhamma birth. Santikaro spent a few years in Swanmok Chaya. He was a close disciple of Ajahn Buddhadasa. And until today, he has been a major translator of Buddhadasa works into English. So for some of us, if we have been able to read Buddhadasa's works, it was through Santikaro's translation. Tonight, Santikaro has offered to give a Dhamma talk on being a student of Buddhadasa. The Dhamma talk will be after our regular meditation practice, about 40 minutes.
Thank you, Paco, and the Buddhadasa archives, and good evening to everyone. This year I've been experimenting with a way of introducing people to the practice of anapanasati, or mindfulness with breathing, which is the primary meditation system taught in the early Buddhist scriptures, the Pali Suttas. And Ajahn Buddhadasa followed this system quite closely. Most often we meet it nowadays in various shortened or truncated forms. But some of us are interested in exploring the whole system, which involves 16 different explorations of Dhamma, body, feeling, mind, and reality, along with breathing in and breathing out. Since we have 40 minutes, what I'll do tonight is, what I often do is a guided meditation, meaning we meditate together and I'll be giving suggestions, advice as we go. And if you wish, you're welcome to follow along. If, however, you prefer to meditate otherwise, nobody knows. Unless people read minds, nobody knows what you'll be doing internally, so it's up to you. So let's begin. Please get comfortable on your cushion. I think of it as taking our Dhamma seat, where we prepare ourselves by being physically present, upright, relaxed, and we create a container for the practice of mindfulness and inquiry within. So we start with being aware of our bodies sitting, and especially if you've only just sat down, taking a little time to settle. And then once you've settled, please bring attention to your breathing. An easy way to begin doing so is to intentionally take a deep breath. Deep but relaxed. And after comfortably filling your lungs, allow the breath to release naturally. And continue paying attention as the breath leaves the body and then finishes. Waiting patiently, we notice another breath. Follow it inward. And take another comfortably deep breath. And when that one is full, it will release on its own if you let it. Please continue taking comfortably deep inhalations and relaxed natural exhalations. And as you do so, you will be attentive and mindful of what the Buddha called long breathing, while breathing in and breathing out. Tonight's talk is on being a disciple of Ajahn Buddhadasa. Towards the end of his life, he once made a statement to the effect, if you don't practice as taught, don't go babbling about my teacher, my teacher. If you spend much time around venerated or famous teachers, there are a lot of people being into the kind of I'm a student or he's my teacher kind of thing, or there are even people who go around collecting teachers. For Ajahn Buddhadasa, this was silly, and he spent a fair amount of time towards the end of his life kind of trying to poke people and get them to pay attention, not to him, not to personalities and charisma, and the kind of emotional buzz or hit that a lot of people are looking for and which they mistake as spirituality, and to focus on Dhamma. So tonight I'd like to mention some ways that someone who really wanted to take on Ajahn Buddhadasa's Dhamma teaching, how they would go about being a disciple or student. And even the way I will present this is somewhat his style. If one chooses another teacher, some of the details are different. They may all talk about mindfulness, compassion, wisdom, whatever, but the specific emphases can vary. And of course, many people want to kind of mish and mash, but if one chooses to really commit and dedicate to a specific teacher, then it behooves us to pay careful attention to what they actually teach. Surprisingly, this is not common. But in the hopes of encouraging it to be more common, I would like to give examples from my own study with Ajahn Buddhadasa for about 9 years while he was alive and continuing since. And all of these are based on what he would call Dhamma principles, which we can absorb intellectually and then digest and learn how to practice in our lives. And even that itself is part of his approach. I don't know how it is, since I don't know hardly anyone here. In America, many people are rather anti-intellectual and not very interested in studying the Buddha's teaching. Of course, I'm speaking very generally. It seems to me in Europe it's a little different. For Ajahn Buddhadasa, there's no contradiction or conflict between intellectual understanding and practice. Some people seem to think it's a conflict or create a conflict. But for him, the two can go together. One without the other could lead to many problems. So much of his teaching was clarifying important Dhamma principles in order that we can practice more deeply, more clearly, and more successfully. And of course, success for him is, success means ending suffering. Not just the big end, what some people call enlightenment, or I would call liberation, but the little ends. If we practice moment to moment, there are moments of suffering, and suffering ends, and it can end through practice. Also, unless you're really stubborn and committed to suffering, it'll end by itself. But that kind of ending, he would call it accidental quenching. But in practice, we learn how to help it end more smoothly, more quickly, and then to dwell with that ending or quenching. So here's some principles to encourage that and help us understand how it happens. One is called Dhamma Patipati, to practice Dhamma according to Dhamma. I don't know how that sounds to you. To me, it's just common sense. If you're going to practice Dhamma, of course you should do it in line with Dhamma. But as I've already said, what happens if we're pretty fuzzy about Dhamma and we start meditating? In Thailand, there are groups that talk a lot about being Nakpatibat, or practitioners. And they say, I don't need to read. But what if you're not clear what the Dhamma is and you're sitting there meditating? Could end up spending our time daydreaming. I've met people who get caught up into a neurosis and they get kind of weird. And they thought it was meditation. For Ajahn Buddhadasa to apply this principle of practicing Dhamma according to Dhamma, that is, not according to our likes and dislikes, not practicing according to fashion or where the big flashy temples are or whatever, but to practice Dhamma according to Dhamma, he would give a lot of attention to understanding the principle of Idapajayata. Idapajayata is the principle that everything happens in connection with, or more literally, dependent upon, conditioned by something else or many things. The key word is pachaya, condition. That is, like when you breathe, the breathing is dependent on a body, on atmosphere containing oxygen, but also shaped by your mood, your health, the temperature, and various things. So nothing happens in isolation. Everything is happening conditioned by other things. And this is at the core of the Buddha's teaching. And so Ajahn Buddhadasa talked about it a lot, even though this word, before he started talking about it a lot, most Thai Buddhists had never heard of it. Even supposedly educated monks. It's in the scriptures, but most educated monks didn't actually study the scriptures. That's a long story that I won't go into. They studied later commentaries rather than the original stuff. But in the original stuff, this principle of Idapajayata, everything is conditioned, influenced, shaped by other things, that this is an ongoing, never-ending process. The more we see this and allow this to guide our practice, the more our practice will be in line with Dhamma. And the understanding I'm talking about, it can come partly from books or hearing talks and from thinking, but it's also our own observation of life. including in meditation, but not limited to meditation. So if somebody's a serious student of Ajahn Buddhadasa, this will be important, and one will explore it in all aspects of life. And it doesn't require that one's a monk or a nun. It just requires that one really pays attention to these things. Closely related to this is Dhamma is nature, nature is Dhamma. And if we wish to understand Dhamma, it's important to live with intimacy with nature. Now, often people understand the nature as the forest, the mountains, the rivers, the ocean, stuff like that. And they look around even this room, well, there's a lot of concrete and some technology. One plant or some cuttings in a vase. But for Ajahn Buddhadasa, this is all nature too, if you know how to look at it. But it's a little easier if you do like he did, and you live in the woods or close to the woods. You live without air conditioning. It's harder to do in Bangkok. But at least open the windows as much as possible. Walk in the sunlight. Don't be afraid of the rain. I'll talk about this one a little further. But to understand Dhamma, live as close to nature as you can. Let nature affect you. Open yourself to nature, whether it's birds or whether it's mosquitoes or whatever. At the same time, don't push away this kind of stuff. If you choose to live in Bangkok, it's your choice. Take responsibility for it. That's the law of karma. And if this is the nature that you live with, explore it and understand this as nature. But when you can, also hang out with trees, birds, rivers, and the like. Intimacy with nature helps us to understand Dhamma, which then guides our practice more deeply. Another aspect of this, which I've begun touching on, is to live simply. There was what he called the motto of Suan Mok, which is, I may get the order a little wrong, my memory's never real good. I get the main points, but I mix up the order sometimes, but the gist of it is to sleeping in a pig's sty. That doesn't mean sleeping in a mess. Some people assume pigs are messy. Actually, they would prefer to be clean. It's the way humans treat them that makes the mess. But to live in sleeping in a pig's sty is something small and very simple. Bathing in a ditch. In the old days at Suan Mok, there was a stream that wove through it. And you could literally just bathe in the ditch. It was clean water. In Bangkok, might not recommend it. eating from a cat's bowl and sleep listening to the mosquitoes sing. So sometimes he elaborated on, I'm just trying to give you a taste of what he also spoke of as simple living, and he used the English simple living and high thinking. We live very simply in order to elevate our minds, our thoughts, our intentions, and our intelligence. Basically, because if the more complicated the way we live, the more energy that takes up, and the harder it is to elevate our minds. Even though nowadays, at least in America, we like to convince ourselves how clever and sophisticated we are. For him, an important principle, which he lived out quite well, and people like myself maybe live out not quite as well, but the place I'm working on in the U.S., as much as possible in the United States, to also try to live simply so that our complexities don't get too much in the way of being intimate with nature and elevating our minds. A fourth principle, which has been very important for me, is, I'll give you the words in Pali first, or in Thai pronunciation, Bali. Sabbe Dhamma Nalang Abhinivesaya, in a Thai accent, Sabbe Dhamma Nalang Abhinivesaya. All things, all dhammas, all natures ought not to be clung to. And he would add to that, as me and mine. The word abhinivesaya, he would explain, means to bury your mind in or to stick your head in until it gets stuck. There are many things in the world that we don't want to have much to do with. Cancer, for instance, or death, or war, or depending on your politics, one party or the other. And then there are all the other things that we end up sticking our heads in and then have trouble extricating ourselves. And Ajahn Buddhadasa's understanding of the Buddha's teaching is, where what gets us really stuck is me and mine. And so, and once the Buddha was asked to summarize his teaching in a few words, and this was it, Sabbe Dhamma Nalang Abhinivesaya, which I usually translate as, nothing is worth clinging to as me and mine. I've believed this for more than 20 years. Putting it into practice is a lifelong process. If you're serious as a student of Ajahn Buddhadasa, this is at the heart of your study, understanding, practice, life, and also service, like the people who work here and volunteer here. If they do so as a true disciple of Buddhadasa, it's in order to let go of me and mine, which gets tricky. Like for me, I have a very deep love for Ajahn Buddhadasa, and so I also need to let go of him as my teacher. Because when I've clung to him as my teacher, I've either looked down on or criticized other teachers, which creates suffering. So that's just one little example of how there's no limit to this teaching. Everything, all things, ought not to be clung to. Nothing is worth clinging to as me or mine. Just to put that into practice takes a lot of mindfulness, concentration, effort, and compassion. To shift this into an area that's also important, I think, for serious students of Ajahn Buddhadasa. And again, it's not about clinging to him as my teacher. He's my teacher, he's my teacher. It's about practicing what he taught. Not because he taught it, but because we investigate it and see for ourselves, oh, this is helpful for, very helpful for quenching suffering. And one can do the same with any great teacher. Another piece that a serious disciple of Buddhadasa gives attention to is what I call learning the suttas, the record of the Buddha's discourses, according to the discourses. Earlier, I mentioned that, especially when Ajahn Buddhadasa was a young monk and studying and starting to preach and teach, the highly educated monks of that time, though it's still largely true in the kind of orthodox Thai monastic education system, their understanding of the Buddha's teaching is dominated by the commentaries that were codified 1,000 years after the Buddha. I'm about to speak a heresy. In most Theravada countries, they believe that they have the original Buddha's teaching. But actually, what they follow is selections that were codified centuries later. And Ajahn Buddhadasa, what I'm saying is something that he himself talked about, but it made many people angry, because part of the identity of being Theravada is we've got the original teachings, not like those Tibetans or Chinese or those Mahayanists. But Ajahn Buddhadasa realized that part of the Theravada identity was a concoction, a fabrication. And because when he started going beyond his own early monastic education and learned to read the suttas for himself, he found many things that orthodox Theravada didn't talk about. A prime example is emptiness, sunyata. In fact, when he started teaching sunyata, he was accused of being a Mahayanist, as well as a Christian, a communist, and whatever. He was trying to ruin Thai Buddhism, they said. But it turns out the people who said this were speaking from ignorance, because they didn't actually know the original teachings because sunyata is prominent. And there's even a place where the Buddha says, at a later time, the monks will be poets and lecturers and scholars and storytellers, but the thread of emptiness will be lost. Sunyata parisanyuta will be lost. So this is the stuff Ajahn Buddhadasa took seriously. So if you're going to take him seriously, which means you take the Buddha seriously, which means for him you take the early teaching seriously, we learn to read those teachings not according to the commentaries 1,000 years later. It doesn't mean we need to ignore those commentaries. They can be helpful. But for Ajahn Buddhadasa, it's more important to use the body of early discourses to understand the discourses. It takes some time. It can be daunting. But for those who speak English or read English, we now have excellent translations. And also there's a new development. And this is also uncomfortable for Orthodox or narrow-minded Theravadins. There's a body of discourses that had been translated into Chinese. They're called agamas, and they cover largely the same material as the Pali suttas. And now there are scholars who know both Pali and Chinese and are comparing the two. And it's a relatively new development, but if you're interested in this approach of reading the early discourses according to what it says in the early discourses, we're getting more and more help, not only from the Pali tradition, but from the Chinese. And if we let go of some of our Theravada ego, or our Mahayana ego, whatever the case may be, we can find a lot of help. Now, of course, not everybody's going to be a scholar. Each of us will go into this material more or less as we're inclined or able. But Ajahn Buddhadasa encouraged this. He also called it digging diamonds from the Tipitaka, or digging jewels. Because as I said, there were certain powerful teachings in the Tipitaka that standard Thai Buddhism, and this means at the biggest temples, the most famous scholar monks, and they weren't talking about anatta, selflessness, sunyata, emptiness, paticca samuppada, dependent co-origination, itapaccha, jayata, tatata. And sadly, they didn't talk about nibbana very much because it was assumed this was beyond most people. So the core, that which makes the Buddha's teaching most relevant and powerful, was sort of left out. And what Ajahn Buddhadasa dedicated his life to and was partially successful was bringing these diamonds back into the understanding of Thai Buddhists, and as time went on, or as we're doing here, to also make this central for people from other countries. So this is another principle that somebody who's committed to Dhamma practice and study, inspired by the approach of Ajahn Buddhadasa, would also learn how to dig these diamonds out of the Tipitaka. To some extent, he did it for us, but he felt, and I've been influenced by this, that to learn to get it in the Buddha's style doesn't hurt. It's fine to read the modern Dhamma books by modern Thai, Vietnamese, Tibetan, American, German, English, whatever, teachers. But let's not forget the Buddha. Because sometimes each culture remakes the Buddha according to causes and conditions. And in America, we're remaking the Buddha into a kind of capitalist, psychologically hip Buddha. And that might be okay, but we might be losing something as well. Another piece that a serious student of Buddhadasa would take on are his three wishes. Originally, these were phrased as, these were his three wishes, or you could say aspirations. And at first they were personal wishes, but later as people accumulated and called themselves his disciples, he expanded it to not only be for him, but those who wanted to follow his approach. The first wish is to personally get to the heart or core of one's own religion, which connects with things I've already been talking about. So, you know, how many Buddha images or whatever, that's all nice, but that's, at least for him, or according to the original teachings, in the Buddha's time, they didn't even have Buddha images. And a lot of the trappings of modern Buddhism, the Buddha did not encourage. So to do some work, to get to the heart for a Buddhist, Buddhism. Later he expanded this to other religions when he started interacting with or having disciples who were Christian, Hindu, Sikh, Muslim, and even Marxist. Mm-hmm. Though that was... had to be careful how you talked about that 30, 40 years ago. So first, getting to the heart of one's own religion or tradition, and that applied even among different schools of Buddhism. If somebody's into Zen, fine, but get to the bottom of it. If somebody's into Tibetan, don't just play around, get to the heart of it. Or if you're into Theravada, fine, go to the heart of it. Second wish is, this was his own wish, he hoped to work for mutual, what he called mutual good understanding, first, say, among Thai Buddhists, and then among Theravada Buddhists, because there's still a lot of diversity in Thai Buddhism. He was a forest monk, but he pioneered a certain kind of forest monk in Thailand. You'll hear about the forest tradition, and there's even some monks who kind of use this word for their group as if they own it. But actually, there's lots of kind of forest monks, including the ones who do lots of magic. They're the shaman forest monks. And these exist, especially in the north and in Cambodia, Burma, and whatever. And then I have many friends who are what are called development monks. And those are just some of the four main branches of forest monks. So anyway, those are just some details. There's so much diversity in Thai Buddhism. So, okay, whatever your style, your approach, get to the bottom of it. And then, so we're not stuck and narrow-minded and building a lot of ego around our particular school, teacher, friends, circles, interact with people's approach who's somewhat different. Other versions of Thai Buddhism, of Theravada Buddhism, other schools of Buddhism, and then other religions. And nowadays, secular humanists, basically anybody who's committed to a better world, lessening suffering, going beyond egoism. These are all allies in the big project of helping humanity to go beyond suffering, which is what Ajahn Buddhadasa thought. He spoke of this as the Buddha's wish. And if you're a Buddhadasa, a servant of the Buddha, you take on that wish. It's not just about my suffering and my problems. That's a starting point, but as we can, we work for helping all humanity or all living things, however you want to talk about. It's kind of a Thai bodhisattva thing, but he didn't talk so much about the bodhisattva thing the way it's talked about in Mahayana Buddhism. But even the Mahayanas talk, the Chinese and the Tibetans don't see eye to eye on that. So anyway, first wish, get to the core of your own tradition. Second, seek mutual good understanding and encourage it. And I'm proud of the archives. They're trying to do a lot of this. Ajahn Buddhadasa is central here, but this is also a place for other teachers, other teachings, and not just Theravada, and not just Buddhist. And then third, if we're well-grounded in our own tradition, if we can have good understanding of other traditions, then we can work together to drag humanity out from materialism. In his time, he focused on materialism. Some of us have updated it to consumerism, which to me is the dominant religion in many places. Definitely in America, they say they're Christians, and some are. But I would say the main religion of America is consumerism. It's pretty strong in Thailand. It's very strong in Japan. The Burmese are opening up to it more and more. And so Ajahn Buddhadasa felt if one is really Buddhist or Christian or religious or spiritual, we're going to be dragging ourselves out from under the power of consumerism, which is powerful. And we all need all the help we can get. And the more we cooperate and support each other, the more we and society and the world can benefit. I don't have time to take this into the ecological implications, the social reform implications, but these are all things he talked about and in many ways pioneered for a Thai Buddhist monk to talk about ecology or what he called Dhammic socialism and so on. How each of us applies these principles is up to us. Part of his style that I appreciated was every time I went to him and asked, what should I do? He laughed at me. He felt his job is to help clarify the principles, but then we're grown-ups, right? And so it's up to us to use our own intelligence, because who's going to know our life better than us? If we don't know our own life, we're in big trouble. And to just go to some teacher and have them tell us what to do, Ajahn Buddhadasa considered childish. And if for children it's okay up to a point, but as soon as possible we want them kids to grow up. And so basically his teaching was for grown-ups, and that's not a matter of age, it's a matter of attitude. And so he felt his job was not to lay out all the details, but clarify the principles and say, okay, it's up to you, it's your life. Work with your friends, colleagues, but figure it out. If you have questions and want to go talk to him, he loved to talk about this stuff. It was funny how few people would do that. They were afraid of him because he was the big teacher. It was like rude Americans like me or some certain Thais who were not so afraid. But most people didn't know how to ask questions. But anybody who would think seriously about these things and have questions, he was very happy to spend a lot of time discussing it, but not telling us what to do. The last thing I'll touch on, because it applies to the archives here, it applies to what I'm trying to do in the US, and it could apply to you wherever you go, whether you spend a lot of time in Bangkok or wherever you go. And this is that Suan Mok is anywhere where there is spotlessness. This involves a pun. Suan Mok. Mok was originally from a certain tree that in southern Thailand is called Mok, a Mok tree. And the original abandoned monastery where he started Suan Mok had a lot of Mok trees. There were also a lot of Pan trees. And so the full name was Suan Moka Palarama, the grove of the power, Pala, of Moka. So it was a pun from Southern Thai and the Pali language. In Pali, Moka or Moksha in Sanskrit is liberation. So Suan Mok is anywhere where there is Moka, liberation. But a third piece of the pun is Mok in Southern Thai also means Gliang. Gliang means spotless, to be unstained, untarnished. if you've heard of the kilesa, the defilements, the way that's translated in Thai, saomong, a better translation is to be tarnished. Our minds are tarnished by greed, hatred, anger, fear, confusion, boredom, pride, envy. It tarnishes. When the mind is untarnished, it's spotless. It's something like purity, but he didn't use the word purity as much because often people get kind of on trips, especially monks. They follow all the rules and get kind of neurotic about purity. So he used the word gliyang at times. So anywhere where there is spotlessness or liberation or luminousness, it's a word from the early teachings. When there's luminousness, mind or consciousness, awareness, whatever we call it, can make contact with and get to know that spotlessness. And then wherever that happens, then it's suan mok. Some people call this suan mok Bangkok. But it's, in Ajahn Buddhadasa's way of thinking, it's only really suan mok when there's spotlessness. And it's not about cleaning the floor. It's about going deeply enough into our own minds and letting go of me and mine. The spotlessness, and this is another important part of his teaching, may only be momentary. But he spoke of that as little nibbanas. The nibbanas, and this is taste of nibbana, so tastes of nibbana, or he also called them free samples. It's not like you have to do it. It happens naturally. You can't suffer all the time, no matter how hard you try. Some people try really hard, but it's just not possible. We will blow fuses or have strokes or whatever. But there will be these little nibbanas, and if we learn how to tune into them, those moments of spotlessness, and then the mind is spotless for a little while, and that's suan mok. Whether it's in Tokyo or Chiang Mai or Germany or Africa, or even the U.S. It might be more difficult there, but some of us are trying. So those are some of the principles that a disciple of Buddhadasa, especially the Buddhadasa that I knew as a human being, would follow. So I hope these are of interest and use for you. You're not required to follow any of them, but if you'd like, you're welcome to. And of course, if the archives or and the archive staff or me can be of service, that's what we do, because that's the example that we're trying to follow. So, if there are any questions, we have 10 or 15 minutes if there's anything you'd like to follow up on. There's a gentleman in the back.
Wow, a microphone and everything. Well, since we're talking heresy, I'll bring up some more. And don't take this the wrong way. I'll put that as a disclaimer. We talk a lot about commentaries, what the Buddha taught originally, and then the commentaries that came afterwards. Of course, the Mahayanas really excelled in this, and they've got tomes of it. As I understand, the Buddha's teachings were not written down for, 400 years after his...
200-something.
Okay, so the first part of the question is, do you really believe that in those 200 years, the Buddha's teachings did not change at all? That there were no extras added in those 200 years? That seems kind of hard to believe for me.
I don't believe that, nor did Ajahn Buddhadasa. What he did believe is enough of the genuine stuff did make it through.
Okay, then the follow-on to that question is, there's as you're probably well aware in the States, there's something called emerging Buddhism, right? Places like BuddhistGeeks.com spend a lot of time talking about what's going to happen to Buddhism as it gets translated into the West. It came originally in Theravada form, then there was an emphasis on Zen, and now the Tibetans hold the limelight. What do you think the essentials, in 25 words or less, what are the essentials that cannot be compromised, that have to make it through in any sort of modern translation of Buddhism?
Well, everything I've talked about, but the core is Sabbe Dhamma Nalang Abhinivesaya, and I can quote the Buddha on that. And not only is there a quote, it's not just that you can point to a text, but if you really read the tradition, that's core, and it's core in Tibetan and Zen as well. Ajahn Buddhadasa he used the word Buddhayana to poke fun at all the later Buddhist schools. And Buddhayana is the Buddha's teaching before anybody messed it up. And he was speaking also of Theravadins. All the schools have Buddhayana, and none of us have it exclusively or perfectly. That's why he was interested in the exchange.
So
nothing is worth clinging to as me and mine. And that's inseparable from emptiness and selflessness. But another one is then itapajayata, that everything depends on other things. So those would be two core principles. And then you can add the middle way.
Okay, thank you.
Those would be some of the core ones but like for the US, one thing I consider is, I don't know, some of these groups seem to lack a commitment to the ethical teachings and to simplicity. And kind of may be getting carried away with all the technology. And I'm not against using it, but I think we need to be careful. So.
Hello. Thank you for speaking so wonderfully on the legacy of Ajahn Buddhadasa. As somebody who is still in the process of learning Thai, I'm just wondering what the plans are for translation of Ajahn Buddhadasa's teachings, and what are the best ways of supporting that those kinds of programs for people who are sort of non-Thai speakers.
Us three and a few other people had a meeting a few hours about this. I'm not sure I can summarize in a minute. Paco is going to be helping to coordinate. Are you interested in helping with the translation itself, or supporting it, or just reading?
Well, I'm not fluent in Thai by any means, so I wouldn't be qualified as a translator. But actually, I had gotten in touch with you before. I'm working on a project, hopefully interpreting some of Ajahn Buddhadasa's work into an artwork in collaboration with Thai students. And so I think it would be very helpful, for example, for someone like me to be able to really go deeper into some of his, what he said about particular subjects that we may use.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a starting point would be during meditation retreats, while he was still alive, he gave a number of talks, and I would do a live translation. And my translations weren't perfect. Sometimes he would have to stop and correct me. I would get carried away with my own ideas, and he would kind of go... But these are now available. And so a starting point would be to listen to those. And that, if you listen to enough, you'll start to hear certain themes again and again, and to get used to those themes. So that's one thing that's available now. And stay in touch with Paco and the archives for further developments. However, please be patient. I have people who've been had to be patient with me for 20 years.
I was also particularly interested in the teachings on emptiness, and I was curious to know how or whether you felt Ajahn Buddhadasa's understanding of the Buddha's teaching on emptiness may differ from other schools' teachings on emptiness.
There's some difference because he worked from the Pali, what's the Buddha is recorded to have said in the Pali Suttas. And so when his book, Heartwood of the Bodhi Tree, was published, there's an old translation and then a revised one. There was, for example, a guy in Singapore wrote, who was a card-carrying Mahayanist, and his, what I consider his somewhat philosophical understanding of sunyata disapproved of Ajahn Buddhadasa's. So I would say some of the philosophical elaboration that has happened in, for example, some of the Tibetan schools, to me, goes a bit beyond practical need. And Ajahn Buddhadasa didn't take it that far. So some difference, but probably not an essential difference. In the early Buddhist teachings, you find very little metaphysics. Ajahn Buddhadasa wasn't interested in that as well, but later Buddhists became more metaphysical. So Ajahn Buddhadasa's take on emptiness was a practical one. And he wasn't as concerned on the philosophical elaboration of it, where some Buddhists are concerned with that.
People who carry on this a tradition and who can teach from his teachings?
There are a few, but most of us aren't monks anymore. Mm.
So what's the practical future of this? I mean, how is this going to be preserved? I mean, if it's going to be at a level of study, then it would seem that there's a lot of financial resources that are available. Perhaps there should be scholarships. It should be promoted through like a university level study and religious studies and getting people to do the sort of research and meditation and study of the original texts, etc., and extend the body of knowledge or develop it more. In terms of the actual practice and so on, you know, unless you have that body of practitioners who can extend it to an English-speaking audience, then it's going to have to be uniquely within the Thai community, and I don't know how that is likely to progress either. I don't know if you have ideas about this.
Oh, sure, lots of them. I mean, the short answer is some of us, see, Ajahn Buddhadasa focused on, in his words, more or less, he focused on clarifying right view. That was the emphasis in his work. Ajahn Chah put a big emphasis on building sangha, especially monastic sangha. And so they had different strengths. Some of us have tried to draw on both. And there's a subset of Ajahn Chah disciples who like Ajahn Buddhadasa very much. There's another subset who hate him, literally. Oh, yeah, there are ones who forbid Ajahn Buddhadasa books in their library because he doesn't believe in the usual rebirth stuff, and some people do. So, anyway, some of us, within our abilities and with the resources available to us, like I'm developing a small place in the States. It's going very slow, partly not being monks. We don't have a lot of wealthy Thai people to throw money at us. And some of us actually don't think that's the way to go. But quietly and slowly, we're building centers and groups of people. And I don't know how far we will get. In my case, I'm getting some support or friendship from the archives like when I come here, we talk about how we can support each other. And so hopefully there will be a small place in the States where people can come, visit, live, stay, to go more deeply into this, not only study, but practice. And but for various reasons, it's less a monastic thing, partly because people like me chose to step away from the monastic approach. And that's partly because, unlike many, Ajahn Buddhadasa stressed more than any other Thai teacher I've ever heard of that whether you're a monk or not is secondary. What matters is that one follows the Noble Eightfold Path. That's pretty much a straight quote. Where in Thai Buddhism, there's a kind of cult of the monk. And it's assumed that being a monk is the path. And they kind of get fuzzy about whether monks follow the Noble Eightfold Path. Of course, the committed monks, like the good monks of the Ajahn Chah tradition, really work at following the Noble Eightfold Path. But Thai Buddhism in particular has this cult of the monk. And that kind of can get in the way of people following the Noble Eightfold Path, including the monks themselves, because then their role is to be an emotional kind of refuge for people. And then that can be a huge distraction. So there are, it's tricky whether you go the way I'm trying to go now or we go to the more monastic route. It's all pretty messy in the world we've got these days. So we do what we can. I'll close because time is up. Ajahn Buddhadasa, once he was, there's this English monk who came to Suan Mok trying to find disciples. He wanted to be a teacher, and to be a teacher, you need disciples, and he didn't have many, so he heard we had a lot of foreigners, so he came down to Suan Mok. And I was talking with Ajahn Buddhadasa, and this guy butted in, and he started talking about, it's really important to have a teacher, right? Everybody has to have a teacher. And this guy was pretty rude. And Ajahn Buddhadasa sat there. I was annoyed. I wanted, I didn't think very much of this guy. But Ajahn Buddhadasa was more patient. Then he listened, nodded his head. And when the guy stopped, and Ajahn Buddhadasa would do this with me when I misbehaved. He would just let me kind of spin my wheels and then stop. And then he said, yes. And the best teacher is Mr. Grope. Now, Grope, unfortunately, in English has a certain connotation nowadays, at least in America. But his example was a blind person with a cane. And that's the real teacher. That's what teaches all of us. And the books or the living teachers can only help us to grope. Our eyes are closed and we're just feeling our way. A great teacher like Ajahn Chah can help us grope more effectively. But if we're not doing that, the best teacher in the world is useless, except for some ego needs. So.
Thank you very much, Santi Caro, Kapung Krap.
My